Sabres have lost 8 straight, but somehow that doesn't drive the point home.
Last time the Sabres won, it was November 2nd.
That's pretty bad. It's just not enough, though.
Last time the Sabres won, it was like 23 degrees Celsius.
All right, now we're talking.
Let's go!
Give me what I want!
Kick down the door!
Drew, you are not doing this!
What the?
Not nice! There's a giant hand!
You hear yourself?
I made like 2,000 of these. I'd like to have fun.
With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Puppies, buddy! You know what? Sabres fans and Sens fans were awful mouthy in the summer, weren't they? They were.
I don't even know if that weather thing is true. Don't look it up. Don't be a nerd.
Leafs win! 5-2
over the Buffalo Sabres. Here, wait. I'm sorry, that was chicken soup for the Leafs fans. So, Steve, they randomly beat the Buffalo Sabres. They didn't win the Stanley Cup or something. Oh, stop, it's not about that. It's not that this win was heroic. At the end of the day, the Leafs were playing a team at home who had lost 7 straight. For most teams, that is great news. That is lunchtime. That is cookie time. That is I'm in a contract year and I'm gonna put up 5 points time. To the Toronto Maple Leafs and their fans, it means impending doom. Especially when the Sabres announced they were starting Juha-Pekka Luukkonen instead of Eric Comrie or Craig Anderson. Ah, that's one of the worst coaching decisions I've ever seen. Craig Anderson backing up against the Leafs in a game the Leafs should definitely win. Dude, that's a 50 save shutout for sure. But somehow, for some reason, the feeling was in the air. Yes, this is a game the Leafs usually lose, but not tonight! Before we break it down, wanna bet? You can do it at Sports Interaction Canada Sportsbook. Does your team have a gimme game that they should win every time, but you feel terrified? Well, you can bet for or against them before the game, live in play, or on one of their many prop bets. Made for Canadians by Canadians, Sports Interaction makes it easy to deposit, play, and cash out. Visit sportsinteraction.com/SDPN. That's sportsinteraction.com/SDPN. Ontario only, 19 plus. Please play responsibly. So, we all had the feeling, oh, okay, this is gonna be a little different. First 30 seconds, first minute of the game, Sabres getting a couple, like, three-on-twos, half three-on-twos, which is not a one-and-a-half-on-one, by the way, math humor. But after a somewhat harrowing first couple minutes, the Sabres were never really in it. Sabres fans, I've been hammering this with the Leafs on and off for a few years now. The Sabres' body language is awful. And it wasn't from the beginning of the game, it was from the moment they gave up the lead. Jordy Benn, noted Norris candidate, gets hooked by Riley Sheahan and the Leafs go to the power play. Riley to Marner for the one-timer right off of John Tavares's knee. And it might have hurt had it not gone in, but it went in, so it didn't hurt. Johnny Toronto becomes the first Leaf to hit double digits in goals this season with his 10th, and the Leafs have the 1-0 lead. So there it is. The Sabres take a penalty. Bad. Allow a goal. Bad. And allow a goal only 13 seconds into the penalty kill. Bad. That's a little bit of adversity. That's things not going your way. That's enough reason to be grumpy. Second goal is where they come completely undone. There's a play at the Leafs bench where Pierre Engvall, I believe it was, touches the puck. And it might have been too many men. Whether it was or it wasn't, I can tell you it was awfully close. And they're freaking out on the Sabres bench right away. All the while, play is continuing, and like, while I understand why you're mad, continue to play, man! Then it goes from bad to worse, Rasmus Sandin dumps it in, and it takes this weird bounce off like the stanchion or the metal with the separating the glass, hits the back of the net, it completely changes its path, and Fitzgerald, the Sabres defenseman who I was not acquainted with before this game, has no idea where the thing is because his back is turned to the puck because he's expecting it to just carom along the boards to where it would naturally go had it not hit anything. Pierre Engvall, facing the play, is like, opportunity. Pierre Engvall just backhand throws it in front, and with all due respect to Cali Yarncroak, I was screaming when the Leafs scored this one because I didn't want him to score it. Look! Pontus Holmberg is right there! Ah! I love when a guy gets his first NHL goal. I wanted him to get it so bad, and he didn't get it. Yarncroak gets his 4th of the season. That's fine. Anyway, Cali Yarncroak scores it in a few things here. One for the Leafs, one for the Sabres. Yarncroak has had his ups and downs with the Leafs and trying to find a spot in the lineup. He played center a little bit, third line, fourth line, the fourth line that is actually the third line, and the third line that's actually the fourth line. But that was his 4th goal of the season in his 19th game. When the Leafs got this guy, I made a point to point out that he's actually a ridiculously consistent goal scorer. Not in that he's always a 30 to 40 goal threat, in that every year you can expect him to be within 5 goals of a certain total. Minimum, he's gonna net you like 12, but maximum he's gonna get you like 8, 18, 17. We'll say 17. 4 goals in 19 games puts him on pace for 17.26. Listen, if you need a relatively quick, defensively responsible forward who's gonna net you a goal every 5 or 6 games, you get Kelly Yarncroke. So that's the Leafs end of things. Sabres end of things. You see it in Jeff Skinner's face on the bench. He shuts off. The whole team shuts off. Like Dylan Cousins, Tage Thompson, Alex Tuch, like guys on the Sabres, individual guys, had good games in this one, but a lot of the guys just shut off. Because that's getting screwed 1,000 ways in like a 10 or 15 second span. There's a penalty that should have been called, maybe, that wasn't called. There's just a ringing around attempt that goes off of everything and somehow ends up in front of and in the back of your net. And then by the time the third goal goes in, less than a minute later, forget it. Oh, but wait! The Sabres' luck might be turning. The Leafs head to the penalty kill, which means the Sabres head to the power play, which means Mitch Marner gets a breakaway. What? I know we all made fun of Alexander Kerfoot for passing on what was essentially a breakaway, but you have to understand, the difference between that play and this one is it was bad when that happened. This was good. Do you want to see what a real playmaker is? Like a true playmaker? Mitch Marner passed this. He passed it. Mitch Marner passed this. He passed it! Dude pulled off his signature move! How is that your signature move? To pass it on a breakaway and have it have a 100% success rate! So, if you watch Hockey Night in Canada with Steve Dangle on the Sportsnet YouTube channel on the stream, I was trying to figure out how many times Marner has done this, and I actually got it wrong. I said it was 3 times, then it went up to 4, and now I'm going back down to 3 because I have it figured out. There was the time Marner had a clear shot with the London Knights, and he dropped the puck for Christian Dvorak, who scored. That's time number 1. There's last year against the Seattle Kraken. Marner drops it for David Kampf, shorthanded. David Kampf scores. That's time number 2, and the first time that he pulled it off in the NHL. Then there is this one, where Mitch Marner drops the puck for Mark Giordano, who puts the puck in, we'll get to that in a moment, but in for a shorthanded goal. If you're thinking, Steve, you skipped one, that's what I thought too, because there was a goal in that ridiculous game that ended 10-7 for the Leafs against Detroit from last season. But what actually happened is the script was flipped. Michael Bunting had a breakaway and he dropped it for Mitch Marner, who scored. It wasn't the other way around like I originally thought. So, I know what you're thinking, what the heck happened here? From Sportsnet's Luke Fox, Mark Giordano's good goal resulted from a review initiated by the Situation Room. Here's the explanation. The Situation Room initiated a video review to examine if the puck entered the Buffalo net in a legal fashion. Video review determined that the puck crossed the Buffalo goal line between the normal position of the goalpost and that Mark Giordano had an imminent scoring opportunity prior to the goalpost being displaced. The decision was made in accordance with Rule 63.7, which states, in part, that in the event that the goal post is displaced, either deliberately or accidentally, by a defending player prior to the puck crossing the goal line between the normal position of the goal post, the referee may award a goal. In order to award a goal in this situation, the goal post must have been displaced by the actions of a defending player. The attacking player must have an imminent scoring opportunity prior to the goalpost being displaced, and it must be determined that the puck would have entered the net between the normal position of the goalpost. So, good to get that explanation, because that's not what I thought the rule was. What I thought the rule was, because I saw Mark Giordano didn't quite get the shot off before the net was taken off, and Alex Tuch just went flying into the Sabres net and crashing into Lucan. But it was an imminent scoring chance, and if you look, it was gonna go in. It wasn't gonna go in by a lot, but it was going to sneak around Lukanen's pad and over the goal line and in the goalpost. Under the rules, that's a goal. Matt Murray makes an excellent save right before the intermission, and that was a key one because I think if the Sabres score that one, it could have been a different game. Even they, in these situations, should be able to defend that 3-goal lead, right? Right? Sandin took a penalty only a couple minutes into the second period, and that was one of the most sad sack power plays I've ever seen. The Sabres looked utterly lethargic. But then they get another break about 6 minutes later. Auston Matthews takes an illegal check to the head penalty on Casey Mittelstadt. Now, I don't think so. I haven't, like, gone through it frame by frame, super slow motion, but that just looked like a clean check. Listen, I can understand how in real time that looked bad. I 100% understand that, how in real time, real speed, that looked bad. I don't really think he got middle stat, and I'd be shocked if this got a call from the league. Shocked. And if it does, why is it always Buffalo? Matthews is a Lady Bing candidate against most other teams. By the way, I like that he's basically completely abandoned trying to win that thing. That's good. But on the ensuing power play, the Sabres are 10 seconds away from blowing it. Until a perfect play executed perfectly. Dylan Cousins fires the puck on from right around the faceoff circle while he's ripping that thing, and it's coming at Matt Murray fast, and it's going high, it's rising on him. Alex Tuck bats it down. The speed is too fast, the change in direction is too abrupt, Matt Murray's not getting that thing, and if he does, it's luck. As a goalie, you'll want to stop the puck any way you can, but you prefer to actually stop the thing rather than just sort of have it hit you. Unfortunately, that one didn't, and the Sabres are on the board. And Nylander, who had a very up and down game in this one, mostly up, takes a penalty. And, like, the Sabres just scored a power play goal, Will! You score another one here, you forget about the crappy first period. You forget about the crappy first power play of this period. All of a sudden, they score on this one, they're within one. But the penalty kill comes up big. And David Kampf, by the way, got the championship MVP belt that the Leafs give out after every game, to give you an idea of how important this penalty kill and the penalty kill in general. And after this kill, he draws a penalty that lets the Leafs go to the power play, which is great because they only scored 13 seconds into the last one. In this one, ooh, not as crisp, 23. Riley over to Matthews for the one-timer. Tavares gets a piece of it, almost puts it in himself, but William Nylander, guess who, finishes the job. 4-1 Leafs, 3-goal lead is restored, and that's how we go to intermission. Third period, the Leafs basically enter turtle mode, and I'm not a huge fan of that, but it worked to great effect against the Sabres. Until John Tavares, like, can I show you something? Look at Tavares, look at him right here. He's standing behind Kerfoot, he's being pressured by a Sabre, he's standing right in front of experience. You see the word experience? That kind of, it's perfect. He's standing right by experience along the boards. He's on his backhand. This is a primary assist. This from here. Like a solid, what is that, 15 feet into his own zone? That's a primary assist. You want to see something even more wild? This is the first time Nylander touches the puck. He's inside the slot. He's 4 feet in front of the blue paint. 3, maybe? When we call John Tavares a hockey-playing robot, I promise it's a compliment. That is a perfectly placed, perfectly executed, heat-seeking missile of a backhand flip out of the zone. For most players, that is a hope and a prayer, but it is you who should be hoping and praying when John Tavares is on the ice, especially this season. Johnny Toronto and Willie does not waste the opportunity for his second of the game, his 10th of the season, tying Johnny Toronto. I know I said season, I meant to say season, but I thought it was a good take. With a little under 5 minutes to go, the Leafs do take another penalty, that's bad. The Sabres end up scoring on the power play, that's bad. But that's as bad as it gets. There was nothing not to like about this one. Listen, Tage Thompson looked great, he was a bully out there. Tuck, Cousins, Skinner had his moments, but I thought he was kind of shook. I liked watching Power and Dahlin, that's fun. But other than that, I don't think the Sabres had a very good game. They outshot the Leafs 12-6 in the second period and 14-6 in the third, but I think that might have something to do with the fact that it was 3-0 after one, and the shots were 11-8 for the Leafs in that period, a difference of 3. But 34-23 were the final shots for the game, meaning Matt Murray made 32 saves on 34 shots in his Leafs home debut. He was magnificent in this one, and the D, I thought, was pretty good around him. Questions. This one is not a question, it's just the standings. At the time I'm shooting this, the Bruins are in first place with 32 points, that's absurd. The Devils have 30 points, also absurd. The Golden Knights have 28 points, and the Leafs are fourth in the NHL. Only a plus 6 goal differential and 24 points. The Leafs are fourth place in the entire National Hockey League. They have 10 wins in 19 games. They have one more win than they do loss. They have won 10 times and lost 9. Fourth place. Listen, you're sending that to me under a tweet asking for questions, and honestly, it's a great question. I know you didn't say anything, but you did. Listen, when I was being negative about the team, especially after their loss to Anaheim, I stand by everything I said. I called it as I saw it at the time, and I still think the team has major flaws. You think the team has major flaws. It's like, who, as much as you've been cheering for the team over this span where I believe they're 6-1-2 over their last 9 games, who hasn't been like, you know what, Sandin hasn't looked very strong in some moments. He looked okay in this one. Who hasn't complained about Hall at any point this season? Alexander Kerfoot still has one goal, and now it's in 19 games. Engvall got his 4th point of the season after getting a big raise. Whoopee. It's okay to praise them when they're good and criticize them when they're bad. But for the people who were like, hey, they started mediocre last year and then picked it up, yes, the Leafs are doing that, exactly that, again. That's not normal. That's not... what is that? That's not a strategy. It's not something they're doing on purpose. It's weird to be bad and then good every year. Just like with the Sabres, how it's weird to be good and then bad every year, except their timeline is way different. Those dudes are like top 5-10 in the league for the first month, almost every year, like first 3 weeks, and they proceed to win maybe half a dozen games the rest of the way. None of that makes any sense, as long as we can agree on that. Not a question, but as a Pens fan and lover of Matt Murray, this is how I feel. And it's a quote from some sort of animated movie. It says, "You're as beautiful as the day I lost you." What the hell? What movie is this from? What movie is this? Okay, I don't know if this is Pixar, but it kind of looks a little like Pixar. And I don't know when it happened that every animated film needs to make you cry. Back in my day, cartoons made you laugh and have a good time. No, I don't want to watch the old man with his balloon and cry. There's a movie about emotions. And yes, I understand emotional intelligence and all that, but have someone step on a rake or something. Jeez, it's Saturday. I'm trying to laugh. I don't need to be feeling these kind of... don't make me feel bad for Penguins fans! You have 3 cups since I started making YouTube videos. I haven't even made a video about the Leafs in the second round. I'm not supposed to feel bad for you. Anyway, yeah, no, Matt Murray. I'm not gonna count the Montreal game, his first game of the season, because that was a long time ago, and also he missed over a month after that with an injury. In his 3 games since returning from injury, or is it 4? Whatever, doesn't matter. He's looked good. He's looked really good. He's given the Leafs a chance to win every single time, and he hasn't really given up too many softies, has he? You wish he did this, you maybe wish he did that, but no backbreakers. Imagine when the Leafs finally have the tandem that they acquired this summer, which they have had for exactly 1 game so far this season, out of 19. Are you planning on going to any live games this season? Jessica, that is a great question. I don't have plans to go to a Leaf game. I want to go to a Leaf game. I'll figure out how to go to a Leaf game. I want to go to at least... I'd like to go to 2. I'd like to go to 2 regular season games, and then obviously in the playoffs. I would love to go to the playoffs. It's difficult with the work schedule. Well, actually, the playoffs become even more difficult because I'm streaming all those games. I do have plans to go to an NHL game this year, but it does not involve the Leafs, and those are the only details I'm giving you, and the thing's not even booked yet, so who knows if it's even happening. I will end with the vibes going around the team right now. From Luke Fox, William Nylander walks into post-game scrum wearing a crisp mauve suit. Top 3 buttons undone. Mark Giordano. Whoa! That is the most William Nylander and the most guy named Mark Giordano thing I have ever heard. That is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Don't forget, LFR is now on Spotify, Apple, Amazon, Google, all of them. Get it there too. Arr.